I have a good sex life, not afraid to say that. I suppose I'm not the sort of person who says anything less than a good sex life.
In this day and age, people are having sex younger and younger. There's more and more sex on TV, in music.
Me and the guy making out on the rugby pitch.
But I am basically kinky besties at this point.
Some edge play includes blood, knives, needles, electro, fire, and consensual non-consent, all that sort of thing.
Just one of those things, like, I'm not ashamed of it. I'm not ashamed of my sexuality. I'm not ashamed of the sex that I have. I enjoy it very much. I enjoy sex.
Well, I mean, the way that I see sex and consent is quite simple. Don't get some until you get some.
That's true. My life is a porn. I just don't film it.
Welcome to the A-Slut podcast with your host, Steel Claw. Now strap yourselves in and prepare for some sexy talk, some educational chat, and terrible jokes. And remember, let's get A-Slut.
Everybody, and welcome to another episode of the A-Slut podcast. I'm in Seattle, Washington right now, in my little Airbnb at the bottom of a little hill. Really, really cool, really, really fun. I'm three quarters of the way through my trip now, I think. Pretty close to that. And it's been awesome so far. Today, on today's show, we have Mistress Jennifer, who is a dominatrix from Houston. And I had a good 45 minute or so chat with her about what she does, what's involved with it, and basically just learning a whole bunch of new stuff around how that all works. It was a really, really cool chat, really, really fun, really entertaining. So that's what you're going to be hearing today. My travels so far have been ridiculous in every sense of the word. I will be doing a review of a club that I went to in San Antonio and some of the people I met there, so that's to come up on another episode as well. I did just recorded yesterday an episode with Gay-ish podcast. So that'll be coming up. Make sure you tune in for that. And don't forget, you can always email the show at theaslutpodcast@gmail.com. You can go to the website, aslutpodcast.com. And you can find me on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, basically anything you like at theaslutpodcast. So do go and check those out. And do feel free to email me, because I love talking to you guys. Or even DMing me on any of the social media stuff. It'd be really, really, really cool. So without any further waiting, here's my interview with Mistress Jennifer. Please enjoy. And always remember, let's get A-Slutty.
My dominatrix, she beats the shit out of me. She smacks me on my ass till it's as red as can be. She says it turns her on. Can't say I like it too much, but whatever she wants.
And welcome to the show, finally, after all this time. Mistress Jennifer, welcome to the show. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm very, very good. We sort of been talking a little bit about meeting up and talking, and I'm really excited about this, because I haven't actually had a female dominant on the show before, so I'm really, really pumped to talk to you over this next week while. But a lot of people won't know who you are, which is probably fair, but tell us a wee bit about yourself, what you do, why you're on the show.
Well, I was asked by you to come on the show. It was a pleasure. I'm so glad to be asked, of course. I'm actually a professional dominatrix and have been for 10 years, based in Houston, Texas. I've traveled all over. I've worked, you know, at many dungeons throughout the U.S., everywhere from, like, L.A. to New Orleans to all over Texas. I mean, it's just been awesome. I also teach classes as well. I've done that, branched out. I do events at different fetish, you know, fetish balls, things like that as well. I also work at the store Adam Neve. So, you know, the BDSM is basically in all aspects of my life and has been for the past 10 years. So it's been fun. It's something that I thought I never would get into, but I just kind of came into it and just kind of been, it's kind of a new thing that I wanted to try and do, and it's worked out really well.
It's awesome that it's worked out, and I love the cheeky wee plug for Adam and Eve there as well. So,
oh yeah, well,
you know, those out there know where you need to go if you need to get even BDSM stuff, because there's obviously an expert who works there, which is really, really cool. And you said you've been in the business for 10 years now. That's a fair stretch in and of itself. Mm-hmm. But sort of how did you get into kink in general, and then moving into a pro-domme?
Okay. Well, I actually found out about the kink world back in, I'd say, 1998, 1999, like 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. I was part of a newspaper. I worked in the newspaper industry for 15 years, sold classified advertising, and we used to get these passes from our clients who advertise with us for different BDSM events, you know, fetish, little underground fetish balls, things like that. They really weren't out there as much as they are now back then 20 years ago. Everything was kind of hush-hush, kind of, you know, taboo. So, I mean, it's really gotten it's more build up over the years and people know more about it now.
There was no FetLife back then either.
No. No FetLife, no any of the other, you know, sites that are still around. But no, we used to get these free passes. We'd advertise for them, and they'd send us, like, these passes and these invitations to these ball, little underground balls. I mean, you really, they wouldn't advertise the balls themselves, really, right, because, you know, they didn't want to have people find out about it, because all the vanilla people would be kind of, you know, turning their nose about it and stuff like that.
Absolutely, yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's... So that's how you sort of started your way into kink. And were you the D type straight away, or did you go through some exploration? Or
I've always been a real dominant person, even when I was a kid, because I'm an only child, and I was very dominant. I thought everything was my way or no way. I was very dominant, even on the playground. You know, all the toys were mine. I wanted to rule the playground and run everything. I wasn't a bully of sorts. Everything, you know, like even the kids, you know, the swings or whatever. You know, I wanted to be the kid that always, you know, ran everything, not in a mean way, but just wanted to be in charge.
Like a godfather kind of way.
kind of, yeah, but it just kind of started out as that, so.
And it's just moved on from there, I guess.
It's moved on from there, and, you know, the thing is that I never really had it in my personal relationships just with my work, because, you know, once I went to these fetish events, you know, I started thinking, this is kind of fun. You know, I saw this one lady wearing all leather, and she had this man in a collar walking him on a chain, and I was like, this is kind of cool. And, you know, we'd sit there and we'd watch her flog him and all that at the St. Andrew's Cross. I was like, this is kind of cool, but, yeah, no, I mean, I don't know. I don't think I could ever want to really do any of that, but things change over the years.
They
so.
Do. They mm-hmm. definitely do. And it's kind of cool that you've evolved from that sort of, this doesn't interest me, and now you're doing it, obviously, yes, on a regular basis.
I do. You know, I have been doing this for 10 years, and, you know, it's just something that I kind of came into, not from really the fetish events. A friend of mine who isn't, she's retired now, but she got me into this. She took me actually to one of her subs, and he asked if I ever spanked anyone, and I was like, no, not really. I said, maybe my child when he was a little younger, but he's an adult now. But it's like, no, not really. And he's like, would you?
Yeah,
and
that's a little bit different.
Right. It was a little different, and I said, okay, so I tried it, and it just kind of was nice. It was very stress relieving, you know, because I still had a teenager at that point, and I was like, you know, this is kind of fun. This is kind of stress relieving. It gets all that stress off from raising a child. And
absolutely.
The
dopamine levels definitely go through the roof,
exactly,
at that point, and you're able just to release everything out there and relax a little bit, and that's part of the thing that I enjoy.
Yes.
About it, and it's a lot of fun. So you said just a moment ago something that I thought was interesting. It's just a professional thing for you. It's not in your personal.
Well, up until like a year or so ago, I am now involved with someone who he actually, I met him through the business, we don't always incorporate it into our personal life, but it kind of comes into, into play because, funny word. Anyway, so, it kind of comes into the relationship because number one, I've known him and that's how I met him in the industry. Mm-hmm. It kind of creeps in there, but I try to keep it separate because, I love my work. I love being a professional dominatrix and have for 10 years, but it's not like you want to take your work home with you. Yeah. You want to keep it separate. It's good to separate your regular life from your work life. You don't want to, intertwine them.
Yeah, exactly. It's the age-old story of, for example, somebody who's a chef.
Mm-hmm.
They're cooking all day. They're cooking all night. The last thing they want to do is come home and cook.
Right.
So they're wanting to...
they want to stay away from food.
Exactly. Maybe not stay away from food, but they definitely don't want to have to do the cooking themselves.
Right.
They want somebody else to be able to...
to do it for them.
Because they've just been doing it all day. Exactly. Sure, they're great at it. They're really, really good at it, but you don't want to do it around the clock.
No.
Nobody wants to do their work 24/7.
No, I don't. I want to just, at some point, I just want to walk away from it at the end of the day and be like, oh, I need a break. I want to get away from this. I love it. Yes, don't get me wrong, but...
The body couldn't sustain that level of dopamine release anyway.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of those things, obviously, I talk a lot about the science behind BDSM and why people enjoy it and why things like drop happen and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And part of it is that the fact that the human body physically can't consistently release dopamine at such a high level. At the end of the day, like you said, you just sort of want to come home and just relax more than anything else.
Get away from it because it just gets, it's wonderful, but it's nice to have that break, just to kind of just have a break.
Yeah. So I guess I know the listeners are going to be curious about this because I have a fair few kinksters on. I have people that aren't kinky that are poly or, because I talk about such a wide array of things. So what are the kinds of things that you do with your subs if you're
Oh, sure, I can tell you. Well, I focus a lot on discipline, like spanking, flogging, caning, even over the knee. I have some old-time, old school, I guess you call them, kinksters that, they grew up getting spanked in school like a lot of people over, I don't think they really do it now anymore, but they did. Like, I'm 47, I'll be 48 in January, and it's like that's what they did when I was in school. They would spank the kids, for being bad, for misbehaving, and that's how they handled the discipline. And I still have, like, men in their 70s and stuff that got spanked, even by their parents. And they want that fulfillment. They want to relive that. They want to relive their youth, And I don't know why they want to get spanked at, their age, but they just want to go back, I guess, to being that time because, I knew they probably didn't enjoy it, but something they got from it, they wanted to continue keeping with it. So it's different.
It just reminds me of a saying that I know. Things we hated as children, naps and spankings. Things we love as adults, naps and spankings.
Exactly. it's not for me, but hey, I'm not one to judge. But yeah, no, I enjoy the spanking. I like the bondage aspect of, having them feel helpless, being tied up. It's just something, I don't know, maybe it's just a power trip, It's just something that I like. I don't know, maybe it's a little sadistic.
The power exchange is a huge thing for me as well as, because I'm a switch, but I'm have definitely on the dominant side, have the dominant tendencies, and it takes somebody out of this world for me to move to the S type sort of situation. So it's when I'm playing with somebody, the roles in that situation are those roles. I can't switch in the middle of a scene or anything like that. I even find it difficult to switch with a single person.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm at somebody's dominant, then I'm their dominant. I'm not likely to switch for them. I would have somebody else that I would be the S type for as opposed to the D type.
Right.
So I find that sort of thing that really interesting where they sit there and just go, that's sort of where it's at.
I can't understand, the dominant, I can understand the dominant and the submissive, but being a switch is something I cannot do personally, because I'm a very dominant person also. Yeah. And, you know, I mean, I know people who are switches, and that's great if they have that kind of, if they can turn it off like a light switch, like, okay, well, I'll be a dominant for this period of time, and then we'll switch up. I'll be the submissive and whatnot. But yeah,
see,
you know,
I couldn't do that.
I just can't do that either. There's no way. I cannot do that. I, you know, I can't put myself, you know, totally in a submissive role. Mm-hmm. Now, personally, I, you know, kind of a little bit teeny weeny, maybe a little bit, give a little bit of leeway on that, but not very much. I still have to tell them how to do things.
Right.
So that's still being dominant, even though I'm, you know, giving myself to be a little bit submissive. It's still being, okay, you need to do it this way. Mm-hmm. This is the way it should be done. So I still run things. So,
yeah. Yes. And another thing that I like to talk about, especially with things like this, is there's obviously a safety aspect around not just the kink actions, but the fact that you're seeing clients.
Mm-hmm.
What sort of steps do you take to ensure safety in these situations?
Well, I always implement consent, of course. The number one key is consent. If you don't have consent, you don't have anything.
Yep.
And I always find out firsthand. I ask a lot of questions. I like to know, you know, if they're new to the scene, mm-hmm. you know.
That's an important one.
Yes.
Because newbies don't know where their levels are at.
Exactly.
And you need to be able to start low to be able to build that up. 100%.
Sorry. You ask questions. I like to know if they're new, you know, if they do have experience, how much, mm-hmm. you know, if they have seen a pro-dom before, what kind of things did they do? You know, of course, it's confidentiality with their subs, but, you know, some of them tell me the names of the doms. They say, mm-hmm. okay, well, I saw Mistress so-and-so XYZ.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, well, you know, if they want to tell me, that's on them. If they don't, I get that too. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I like to ask, you know, what is your level of experience? When's the last time you played? I like to know that too. Because some of them are like, oh, I went and saw somebody like 2 years ago, 3 years ago.
Which
and
is a like, long, long time.
It's a long time. It really is. So I just like to ask questions, find out as much possible. I ask them, do you have any health problems, anything mm-hmm. that will hinder you from any of the things that we try? You know, I like to find out all those things. You know, I screen them pretty heavily. You know, I like to
I was
going to
ask about your screening questions.
Oh, yeah, I screen. I not only look on a couple of web boards to see, you know, if they have any black listings against them, and if mm-hmm. they do, I bring that up. I mention it. I said, hey, you know, I've noticed out there on the internet, you know, I do screen you, as you probably can imagine,
yeah.
but I see that you've been blacklisted in this certain area, like, you know, like you didn't show up or whatnot, you know, and that is a big turnoff for me. I'm mm-hmm. like, I usually don't take their appointments if they've seen they've been blacklisted. If they have a new number, then that, you know, they tell me that and they actually show up. But like if they do, you know, schedule the appointment and tell me they have a new number, don't show up, then I know they're lying.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So, I mean, it's out there, you know. I just like to make sure, you know, what they do for, you know, their employment. I have them send me a picture of them. I mm-hmm. like to do a phone interview so I know who I'm talking to.
Yep.
So, you know, kind of get to know them. I've even met them at my store and in person and stuff to kind of pre-screen them as well.
Yeah.
So I like to know who's coming to see me. Exactly.
Very, very clever. Because mm-hmm. there's... Yeah, there have been some absolute horror stories of people just sort of,
believe
sort of going
me,
for it.
I have met, you know, and I've met some, you know, undesirable people out there. Even when they come to the store, you know, I never judge a book by its cover, but if they give me kind of a creepy vibe, I definitely don't want to see them.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Absolutely. And there are a lot of creepy people out there.
There
that's
are.
For sure.
They come into our store every day. We have to, you know, we are very cautious, very on guard. We have to make sure that, you know, they're all on that, you know. If they're creepy and we get that vibe, we, like, you know, basically tell them, you know, to leave, you know, and it's, it just doesn't make us feel comfortable.
I imagine there's the odd one that hangs around for just a little bit too long.
We do. We have some that just kind of linger, and it's like, okay, you know, are you doing okay? You check on them, and then they're just still there, and I'm like, okay. And then usually at that point, I tell my coworker, because we work with a lot of our people. We have guys and girls who work together because we want to make sure we're safe.
Yeah, which is awesome as well.
Mm-hmm.
What measures do you put in place? You know, you've met a client for the first time. You've vetted them. Everything's all good. When you first actually meet them in person outside of the store, so perhaps in a private setting, what kind of do you have anything in place in that sort of situation from that point?
like as a session?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
So just safety, and it's your first session with a person.
I usually sit down with them first, mm-hmm. and we talk about what's going to go on in the session, because, you know, I need a game plan, you know, yeah. In the pre-screening, I find out what their interests are, you know, are they more into pain, are they more into electro, are they more into, you know, just different categories, and I take notes, actually, as I go along, and yeah, I build profiles on all my people, so, mm-hmm. like, you know, I'll sit down when they first get there and hear and go, you know, hey, you know, tell me again what you're into. Do you want to be spanked? Do you want electro? Do you want sounding? What kind of things are you looking for? And then we figure it out, and then we start, you know, getting everything ready to play. So,
and is it from that point right there when you're starting to get everything ready? Is that when the scene starts for you, or
normally, yes. It's like a pre-scene, and then I go into a scene because yeah. you know, I am, that's like preparation. You know, I like to yeah. prepare. I'm definitely prepared for all of my, you know, my sessions. And I actually kind of, you know, when I pre-screen them on the phone or in, you know, over the pre-screening, I tell them, okay, when I find out what they want, I tell them, okay, well, I'm going to put these certain things. I even categorize and put my items aside of what I'm going to yeah. use, like my implements yeah. and things like that. So I'm prepared. And I'm like, okay, well, this guy wants to be spanked. This guy wants electro. So I'll pull out like the violet wand, the tens unit, the paddles, whips, whichever they want. So, mm-hmm. and have it ready.
And I guess you'll have some regulars that you'll just know straight away what they're after as well. So as soon as they book a session, you know, okay, I'm gonna do this, and that's how it is, right?
Right, because I build profiles on them, and I know, and a lot of them I've known for many years. I mean, mm-hmm. I have subs who've been coming to see me since the beginning, which is awesome, you know. And
yeah, that's really cool.
It's unheard of, right? You know, this day and age, because the scene has changed so much. All the stigmas and all the censorships and all the things like that. It's really changed. So it's good to have, you know, I have a steady base of clientele that have, you know, they don't come to see me every week. Maybe once a month. Maybe yeah. every other month. But they consistently are still there, and they still, you know, I've had them find me after 2 years. Oh, I'm so glad you're still around. I thought you were out of the business. You know, I couldn't find you. But actually, if they really want to find me, they'll find me.
They'll find you, yeah. Mm-hmm. and that's really cool as well. And it must make you feel good about what you're doing as well, that these people do want to keep coming back. Because I'm imagining, well, not imagining, I see it quite a bit, that there's more and more people getting into it and more pro-doms coming into the scene as well. So the fact that they would like to keep coming back is, I think, a really, really cool thing as well.
There are a lot of pro-doms out there. You know, I don't know. It's hard to gauge, like, of course, how many, because, you know, we have had a lot of websites shut down and censored. So, I mean, because there used to be so much...
Yeah, cost assistance.
Right. It used to be so much easier to access them and find them and, you know, but I do also have girls who come up to me and say, hey, you know, I want to be a professional dominatrix. Mm. And I was like, do you really? You know, it's it's not an easy business, let me tell you. It's tough. And, you know, it's
Well, there's
really,
still a lot of stigma around it, really.
There is. And dealing with, like, the human trafficking stigma and all that stuff, mm-hmm. too. And it's like we've had a lot to deal with in the past 3 to 4 years. They've had, you know, numerous websites being shut down. And that kind of, you know, hinders how we get our name out there. But we still find a way to do it. You know, mm-hmm. I still find a way to reach my people. The ones that are left, the websites that are left, I use all the social media. Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, Tumblr. I even use, like, you know, Yelp and, you know, whatever, however means we can get out there. And I have a website, too.
Well, it's self-marketing, really,
yes.
isn't it? You've got, that's what you're doing, is you're marketing yourself and what you can do.
Exactly. And, you know, since I have newspaper background, advertising background, you know, it kind of helps that, you know, I write my own ads and things like that and, mm-hmm. and know how to market myself. But really, it helps having that foundation because, you know, it's different for somebody who doesn't have that. You know, they don't know how to really get the word out there. But, mm-hmm. you know, and I market all the events I do, too. I put all of the flyers, you know, out there. I even drop business cards around the neighborhood and mm-hmm. put them in the stores and the different, you know, area, you know, like even the BDSM stores, whatever, whichever ones we have around our neighborhood, I'll just drop them off and keep them there too.
Oh, that's really, really cool. Mm-hmm. And part of that shows how, I guess, I can't think of the word. Sorry. It shows how much you back yourself as well, not just sitting there and your work ethic. Work ethic, so that's the word I'm looking for, is your work ethic to mm-hmm. go out there and put yourself out there. I think there's a lot of people, especially in the digital age, that rely solely on, you know, their Instagram page or their Twitter page, or and that's all they've got. They don't think about these extra ways to be able to go out and market themselves, or they don't want to know. Right. I think some of them don't even want to know. It's too much hard work for them.
Well, I think it's all about hard work. I mean, you've got to put a lot into it. If you don't put a lot into it, you won't get anything back from it. And that's kind of like what we did, you know, even back in the advertising age when I did the newspaper, you know, print advertising. Mm-hmm. You know, we went out there and we, you know, had people, we helped create their ads and stuff. And, you know, you have to have something that pops, that catches yeah. their eye, something, a catchy phrase or a picture that stands out. Mm-hmm. So you have to have something that really will get their attention. And now, I mean, I market myself as much as I can, because if I don't, I won't get any, you know, people, or, you know, I won't have people find me. I'll be limiting mm-hmm. myself. Exactly. And that's bad. I mean, yeah, there are a lot of girls out there that are like, oh, I have to depend on my Twitter page. Twitter did nothing for me up mm-hmm. until, it still really doesn't do a whole lot. I yeah. mean, I reach people, but I really honestly don't get a lot of submissives or you know, possible, you know, submissives to come and see me. Mm-hmm. If you rely on that, then you're really going to not make money as yeah, much.
You're going to struggle exactly. quite a bit.
Exactly.
But again, I think that that's the digital age for you, though, mm-hmm. is that, okay, everything's just social media and that's, I can get by that. Sure, there's some people that do that, but it's one in how many that that actually make it into that sort of,
right.
that onto that sort of level. What this is a question that I really enjoy asking is what are some tips for a submissive who's contacting you for you to, you know, be to accept them, or because, you know, or even on a first meeting, because I've spoken to sex workers and, like, you know, too much cologne, you know, that sort of thing. What are some tips that you would?
Well, I like to make sure that, you know, they are very upfront with me, very honest. They are, you know, if they don't provide me any information, or if they're very vague, then I will not take their appointment. I like yeah. people to be straightforward with me. You know, I come from a corporate background age where, you know, you shake hands, you know, everything is professional. I mm-hmm. mean, if they get unprofessional with me, I don't see them. Yeah. I usually, even on social media, I'll block them. I'm really good at blocking and deleting people. It's awesome. You know, and it's like, I have no bad feelings about it either. But yeah, if they're not going to be honest with me up front, tell me exactly what they want, mm-hmm. and not be reluctant, you know, because when I travel, especially, even, you know, I get deposits, you know, because I want to secure the time, you know, when I go work at the dungeons and whatnot, mm-hmm. you know, I like to make sure, and my time is valuable, and I know yeah, theirs is too.
Absolutely.
And then, yes, when they book the appointment, I want them to make sure that they show up. You know, that's why I get the deposit, to make sure. I mean, mm-hmm. I have guys who prepay their whole sessions, which is amazing. I love that. Or they put down their deposit towards their session, which is good. So I just want them to be honest with me. Honesty is the best thing. There's so many flakes out there just yeah. in life. I mean, it's just, if you say you're going to do something, do it.
Yeah, and it's as simple as that, right? The one of the scariest things for me when I'm talking to people about being a submissive is the question around boundaries. Mm-hmm. What boundaries have you got? The scariest answer is, I don't have any.
Oh no, I have boundaries. I have tons of boundaries.
Yeah, yeah. But so when I'm talking to someone and mm-hmm. I ask them, mm-hmm. I go, well, what limits do you have? What limits do you have? Mm-hmm. And they sit there and go, oh, I have no limits. You can do whatever you want. That scares the shit out of me. Mm-hmm.
It does me too. You know, I'm like, you know, I like to know, you know, I ask them in their interview, I said, you know, are you into more of the, you know, pain, as I said, mm-hmm. pain or pleasure? And then when it comes to that, you know, there are boundaries that, you know, I say, okay, well, you know, number one, I don't deal with needles at all. I mm-hmm. don't deal with, you know, like scat. I don't deal with, you know, golden showers. I don't do any of that stuff. Yeah. I stay away from that because, number one, it's just not me.
Yeah.
You know, and I would never offer that. But no, I just like to, you know, I tell them my boundaries, and we kind kind of establish boundaries. We talk about it even in the pre-screening because
yeah.
I like to know, you know,
exactly
and
where
even
you stand.
Right, even with spanking, you know, a lot of them tell me, you know, I don't want marks. I don't want, you know, this and that. You know, I don't because they have a significant other
mm-hmm.
and they don't want to go home and have to explain why is my bottom pink or why
yeah.
do I have marks on my butt? You know, it's
mm-hmm.
like, you know, I have whelps on my butt, you know, mm-hmm. and everything. And
as
know.
Long as you have that knowledge that. That's what they're after, then it's fine. It's not an issue because
okay.
you can work around it.
Exactly.
Which is
that's how I really plan it. I plan it around, you know, I make like a little lesson plan. I feel like I'm a teacher kind of, you know, I make
mm-hmm.
a lesson plan and I'm like, okay, well, this guy, he likes this, this, and that. He doesn't like this, this, and that. And normally, even in like, even if they email me, they'll say, hey, you know, I'm not into this certain thing or that certain thing and let's stay away from that. I'm like, no
mm-hmm.
problem. And then we establish it. And then once I've seen them, you know, I kind of make a mental note of that as well and
yeah.
just kind of know.
And that where that becomes difficult, I think, is when you're speaking to somebody who's completely new
mm-hmm.
to fetish or BDSM
mm-hmm.
or kink or whatever adjective you wanna,
mm-hmm.
wanna do, and they
mm-hmm.
and they genuinely don't know at that point what they're into.
Mm-hmm.
How have you had someone like that, and how have you dealt with it?
I have, and you know, I ask them, you know, do you like pain more or do you like pleasure more?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I like to ask because, you know, that's kind of a good way to kind of get into it. It's
yeah,
like,
that's
you
a
know,
good starting point.
You know, are you subjected to pain? Do you have a high pain tolerance? You know, tell me up front. I like to, I just ask a lot of questions, you
yeah.
know, and that's the only way you'll, if you don't ask, you don't know.
And the thing about asking questions is I think it makes the other person feel more comfortable as well.
Right.
Because they're sitting there and going, this person knows what they're talking about. They're getting information, so they know that I'm...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Except for the one that asks so many questions. I mean, I get overwhelmed sometimes. I mean, and I know they're just... Sometimes they're wasting my time, sometimes they're not. But they'll just ask so many questions, one after the other, another, another. And they want me to describe what's going to go on in the scene, in the session.
At that point, you just think they're trying to get off.
Right. And I'm like, look, you know, if you really want to book this session... you know, stop asking me questions. I'll say, okay, questions are over. Either
mm-hmm.
book it or move on.
Yeah.
Leave me that alone.
and that's sort of fair enough because you don't want to sit there emailing or whatever back and forwards for however long.
It just wastes time.
And then they don't book a session because
mm-hmm.
you've told them everything they wanted to know at that
or
point.
Or they ghost. They just disappear.
Yeah, which is, yeah, I imagine relatively common as well, which would suck.
It does, you know, especially when I've, you know, etched out the time and everything for them.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, I can't exactly drop what I'm doing and say, you know, okay, you know, I mean, sometimes I can. Sometimes it works out. Like if I have open time, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
I usually don't do last minute appointments because, you know, I do work at the store and I do have events that I do and I do travel somewhat.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so it's like.
Quite difficult
you know,
to get that.
Right, I just can't drop what I'm doing. And, you know, sometimes it's possible, though. There are instances when I can do that. But.
Yeah. But it's not quite
very rare.
I find it quite interesting that, you know, the too many questions and things like that, which is completely fair enough.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a little bit strange in how I go about things when I'm meeting new potential subs.
Mm-hmm.
I have a verbal screening process where it's just a sort of casual chit-chat. And then this is the weird part that
mm-hmm.
I get into.
Mm-hmm.
If it's going to be anything more than just like a tastings
mm-hmm.
sort of thing where I'm, somebody hasn't tried something and they want to try a little bit of it,
uh-huh.
that's fine. That's fine there.
Mm-hmm.
But if I'm going to go into like a DS dynamic with somebody or even just a play partner situation, I have two quite long forms that
okay.
I get people to fill out. And the people listening have heard about these forms and I've even sent a couple out to people.
Good, good.
But one of them's 13 pages
uh-huh.
and it's like a ticker box sort of form.
Mm-hmm.
And it just has a whole bunch of actions and places where those actions will occur. And they'll go,
mm-hmm.
Again, to try or no thanks. And they just tick a box.
Mm-hmm.
And that, one, it helps them learn a lot more about themselves, about what they might be interested in.
Mm-hmm.
And two, it helps me know what they're interested in and how I can cater everything from there.
Mm-hmm.
The second form I've got is basically it's kind of a consent form, but it's also, you know, dangers, what can happen in a scene.
Right.
Have you ever gone non-verbal? Have you ever had a freeze response?
Mm-hmm.
You know, all that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Are you happy to help out with pack-up?
Mm-hmm.
If something goes wrong, will you talk about it in a mature way?
Mm-hmm.
And it's a weird process, and I've had a lot of pushback from it.
Mm-hmm.
Not a lot, but I've had some pushback from it because
nice.
It is such a big thing.
Mm-hmm.
But I sit there and go, if you want to be safe and I want to be safe, then this is what I need. If you're
mm-hmm.
not going to do it, then I'm not willing to play with you.
Yeah, right.
because this is my process and this process is here for safety of you and of me, and so we have a line in the sand there.
Gotcha.
There's no boundaries that can be overstepped. Mm-hmm. And it sort of sounds like that you do that just verbally, which is...
I do, and, you know, but then I also, like, I'll usually send it, like, in an email as well, mm-hmm. so I'll get them to respond in, yeah. in written form as well. You know,
and
I don't
that
have...
way you've got everything there in front of you.
Exactly.
If anything happens.
Exactly.
It does happen.
You know, and I mean, I think the forms are great. I think that's a great idea. But number one, you know, it's a lot of paper.
Yeah.
People don't. Some no, people don't are not.
I don't paper
to fill out. Oh, you don't paper.
No,
you email
Google
it.
Docs.
Oh, good. Okay.
It's all on Google Docs. Okay. So I've got a base copy,
okay.
and then I'll make a copy, and it'll be BDSM checklist, and then the name of the person.
Nice. Okay.
And that way, I know exactly who it is. I can go back to my computer at any time
okay.
and go. Okay, that's where we're at.
Okay.
But I also don't think that that would work being a professional, because
mm-hmm.
people just want to come in and do their thing. They don't want to sit there for maybe half an hour
right.
or longer to fill out a form.
But, you know, the dungeons, though, that I work at, I have one that I work at in L.A.,
mm-hmm.
Sanctuary LAX. It's awesome. I've worked there for the past almost 3 years now,
mm-hmm.
and that's my home dungeon when I go to L.A.
Mm-hmm.
I am always a visiting dom.
I have
now.
To go back there.
Yeah, it's awesome. It's wonderful. So, no, but they do. I mean, they have a pretty, you know, rigorous screening process, because they have a lot of people that just walk in.
Yeah.
They have walk-ins, which I've never seen that before.
No,
you know?
That's a little bit
oh,
weird,
I'll just
yeah.
stop by, and I'll just go get, you know, spanked, or I'll get some bondage done. Let me just go stop in.
Just walking down the street.
Right.
Just nip in for a,
let's just
nip
stop
in for a spank or two.
Right. Let me just go see a
almost
pro-dom.
Like a bar.
Right. Exactly. Let me go see a pro-dom for an hour or two, and then, yeah, and then I'll just go on about my day, finish up what I'm doing for the rest of the day. It's like, it's so random, and it's funny because I've never been subjected to that, so their screening process is amazing. It's really,
and that's
really,
good.
And it's effective. It's very effective. But yeah, it's like, okay, you know, when we find out, you know, the doms that are on staff, you know, we go and meet them, and we all, one by one by one, and interview the person too, which is good.
Right,
we can sit
that's
down
very
and talk
cool,
to
yeah.
them and meet them.
And you
and
can
then,
get a vibe from them from that point as well.
And then you can figure out which one they want to work with, and they go from there. They have choices.
That's really cool. I like that. I like
I
that quite a lot.
Too. I do too. It's great.
A couple more things
mm-hmm.
Just before we finish up. We're
okay.
almost
sure.
we're almost at time.
I agree.
First of all, a lot of people believe that a pro-dom is the same as a regular sex worker where there's sex involved. Quite often that's not correct, though, is it?
It's never correct.
No.
I don't offer that. I mean,
I think most don't.
I see, I mean, there are some women out there who cross the line, and they still try to, I hate this, they try to call themselves pro-doms or professional dominatrix. And,
yeah.
you know, I know I have nothing against it. I have friends who are number one burlesque dancers. I mean, I have friends who are strippers. I have friends who are all kinds of sex workers, you know.
Yeah.
And I don't judge them at all. I love them all the same.
Mm.
And, but, you know, that's just my personal preference. I don't offer that because, number one, I don't feel comfortable with that. I
yeah.
mean, even as a young adult, when I, you know, was in college, you know, I'd go out with my friends and stuff. And I wasn't the girl that always just randomly met some guy and brought
mm.
him home. I'm not that kind of person, you know. My relationships, number one, are pretty, you know, long term.
Yeah.
You know, I've been married. I have a 22-year-old son, and I've been divorced 20 years. And, you know, I'm not looking to get married again. But plus, I'm just not that girl.
Yeah.
I just have to, and I tell them up front, you know, no, I do not offer sex. No, I do not offer, you know, these certain things. You know, I don't
yeah.
offer that because, and there's a lot of women who do. Even our pro-doms, they cross that
yeah.
line.
100%.
Which is wrong.
yeah, I couldn't agree more.
They're glorified, I hate to say this, glorified escorts, and they try to phrase themselves as pro-doms.
Yeah. And unfortunately, they're more common than people think as well.
They are. And, you know, they think it's okay, and it's not.
No, it's not. I do actually have two more.
Okay, sure. This is awesome.
yeah. I'm glad you're enjoying it, because
yeah.
this is great insight for me as well. I'm learning a fair bit, which is part of the reason why I do this, is so that I can learn as well. But you've noticed a few times that you're a mother to a 22-year-old.
Mm-hmm.
Does he know about
yes, my son, yes, he knows about what happened, what's happening, you know, in my life. He knows I've been a professional dominatrix for 10 years. Mm-hmm. He knows I do the events. He's actually come to one of my events, actually, with his friends. He brought a group of friends. They did a birthday party for me. There's a group I'm part of called Kinky Tuesday, and it's at a club called Numbers here in the area, in the Montrose area. And I've been part of that for 5 years since the beginning, and I'm actually their resident. Cool. I'm one of the resident doms there, and right. So I set up the spanking bench, and I do the spanking and floggings, and we do that on stage with the St. Andrew's Cross. But right. It was my birthday a couple years ago, and he had planned, you know, with his friends. He said, okay, I'm going to bring my friends out. So he brought, like, a whole group of his friends out to the bar, and, you know, they were, I think he was 19 at the time, he was. And, of course, they didn't drink. They had to get the wristbands, which was funny. But, I know, it was awesome. So he stayed for a little while. They stayed about 30, 45 minutes. He's like, okay, Mom, I'm out. I'm going home. I'm done. I'm good. But, you know, he actually came out and supported, which is awesome.
That's really cool.
Yes, and funny story is that he works at a smoke shop / adult novelty store.
Right.
So he sells what we sell. He sells a lot of our BDSM stuff, so it's kind of ironic he's in this thing, too. So he never thought he would be, but yeah.
So your son is working for the competition?
It's not really a competition because their store is a smoke shop. We don't sell smoke products. Yeah. We never will. But they do sell the bondage stuff and the novelty toys, all that stuff.
Mm-hmm. How did the discussion with him come about what you do?
Really wasn't a discussion. This is the craziest story I've ever experienced in my life. It's not a story. It's real. I'd been working, and I picked up his friend and him from school or whatnot, and dropped them off at his father's house, my ex. I went to the grocery store. I was going to go get them some sodas and drop them off there.
Yeah.
Funny story. And then I end up dropping them off, and then his dad comes home from work, and I left my bag of implements because I didn't want them taken, you know, because I don't leave anything in my car, you know, when I leave, you know, I just leave everything inside. So I was like, let me put this in there, and I put it in there, and I come back, and everything's out on display when I come back to the apartment, and I'm like, okay. So that's how I found out. And I was like, he's like, what is this? And I told him, I said, well, your mom, you know, I spank people, you know, and I discipline them, you know, when you're bad and you've done something really naughty, I have to discipline them. And he's like, you have to? I was like, yes, I have to. So he was like, okay. So, and I thought he was going to get teased at school, but no, he ended up being very popular in school.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, it was funny. That was a funny story.
So it was almost quite a natural thing, and he just sort of went with it, and it was okay, which is really, really cool. And like you said, he supported you by throwing a birthday party.
They had a party for me, and he came, and it was so funny because, I was like, I invited him and his friends. I didn't think they'd show up, and they did. They stayed 30 minutes. Even one of his really good friends, you know, stopped and had a birthday present, but he made me come outside to pick it up because he was a little embarrassed to come in. He's like, I don't want to go in there, but okay. Yeah.
That's still quite cool. Last point, just any tips for anybody wanting to become a pro-domme?
Yes. Be realistic.
Like we said, there's many people that go and try and do it. I use air quotes, but
They try and do it. I mean, I even have this one girl who still is emailing me and texting me and stuff, and on social media. She wants me to teach her, and I will teach her. I told her to come out to one of the events or something, and I can sit there and I can try to teach her some tips. Mm-hmm. But be realistic. Don't think you're going to get rich on this. You're not. It's not, you know, some make a lot of money, you know, and I've done quite well with this profession in the past 10 years, mm-hmm. but you got to be realistic. Don't set yourself up for something and think, oh, I'm going to be this, or I'm going to make this, or, you know, you just have, and with all the censorships and all the stigmas now, you have to be realistic because it's not going to be as easy. You really have to put work into it.
Yeah.
It's a lot to deal with. It's, you know, it's time consuming. It just is. And
well, yeah, because you've got the whole vetting process, you've got what each wants to do, and like we spoke about before, the self-marketing side of things takes up a lot more time than I think people realize.
Yes, you got to put a lot of time into to marketing yourself. It's just like, oh, I'm just going to put this out here. No. We had an
event. It's not that simple.
No, in our events, you know, I market them everywhere, and I keep marketing them. You have to put a lot of time and effort into it. So yeah, a lot of the girls like, oh, I'm gonna make this money this way, and I was like, no, you have to be realistic. And don't think, you know, don't set yourself up for something that you can't, you know, you can do your best, but, you know, don't expect it.
Especially when you're starting off. Right. You're not going to get all this clientele rushed towards you because you're new, because everybody else is also saying that they're new.
Especially now because of all the censorships. I mean, 10 years ago, things were so easy. I mean, all these websites were up, you know, Backpage, Craigslist, all these. But I never, you know, I never used Craigslist because I thought it was too shady. I just didn't like the people, too creepy.
Yeah.
But yeah, but I mean, there was a lot out there. And, you know, there was more accessibility, more ways to be visible.
Yeah.
But it's changed, so. It's okay. I still deal with it, though, and I still do well with my people, so I'm good.
So it's basically just realizing what your expectations are.
Right, and don't set yourself up for, and don't, you know,
well, setting the correct expectation.
Exactly. Also, you know, I mentored some doms when I first started out at the dungeons and stuff, but you don't copy yourself either. Don't try to be like a certain dom. Everyone's different, and you should tell your own style to you, your personality. Don't do it just because 100%. Mistress So-and-so is like this or Mistress So-and-so is like that.
100%.
Do your own thing. Do you. Be who you are.
And that's where I'm glad I'm at where I'm at, because my Fetlife name is The Opera Ghost,
okay,
after Phantom of the Opera. So a lot of my style of things
I'll
is quite...
I'll have to follow you.
Yeah. a lot of my scenes and stuff are theatrical in nature, and it ties in with the Opera Ghost side of things. And I've done Phantom of the Opera scenes where I've had the mask on and I've removed the mask and it's got the grotesque part on there.
Ooh, how cool.
And just all things like that, which makes it all a little bit different. The other thing that makes me different to a lot of other people is if I'm using a crop or a paddle or something like that, I can hit the exact same, you know, 2-inch by 1-inch square on a person, and I'll hit the exact same spot 10 times in a row.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a sensation that most people can't or haven't dealt with before, because it's, you know, a relatively large area if you're using the an arse, for example. Mm-hmm. It's quite a large area, and to hit the exact same little square on that large area, it's not an easy thing to do. And I think it's because I came from playing drums and I can just sort of click that exact same spot.
Yeah, exactly. And that's cool.
It's those little things like that, I feel, is what separates separates dominance or even submissives in that way, whether they can take like that or whatnot. But yeah.
Cool. Well, I'm also on FetLife, so look me up. Mistress Jen 41 is my name. So
that's what I was going to say. Just to finish this off, go plug yourself any way that you
want. Okay, let's see. I'm on Instagram. It would be Mistress Jennifer 41. Twitter is GothChick. GothChick 16. And then I did the FetLife. That's about it. And, you know, you guys can reach out to me if you want to set up a session, whatnot. You know, contact me and we'll start the screening process and go from there.
Awesome. That's awesome. So, yeah, guys, make sure you do hit up Mr. Jennifer. It's been an awesome chat. Thank you so much for taking
time.
Yeah,
thank
you.
I appreciate it. Thank you for coming
to
see me. Yes, it's been
awesome. Yeah, it has. I've really enjoyed it. Like I said earlier, I've learned a whole bunch from this as well, which is why I do this, and it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you.
You're welcome.
The touch of your lips, dear, but much more for the touch of your whips, dear. You can raise welts like nobody else as we dance to the masochism tango. Say our love is a flame, not an ember. Say it's me that you want to dismember. Blacken my eye, set fire to my tie as we dance to the masochism tango. At your command, before you here I stand. My heart is in my hand, yes. It's here that I must be. My heart entreats, just hear those savage beats, and go put on your cleats, and come and trample me. Your heart is hard as stone or mahogany, that's why I'm in such exquisite agony. My soul is on fire, it's aflame with desire, which is why I perspire when we tango. You caught my nose in your left castanet, love. I can feel the pain yet, love. every time I hear drums. And I envy the rose that you held in your teeth, love, with the thorns underneath, love, sticking into your gums. Your eyes cast a spell that bewitches. The last time I needed 20 stitches to sew up the gash you made with your lash as we danced to the masochism tango. Bash in my brain and make me scream with pain, then kick me once again and say we'll never part. I know too well I'm underneath your spell, so darling, if you smell something burning, it's my heart. Won't you take your cigarette from its holder and burn your initials in my shoulder, fracture my spine and swear that you're mine as we dance to the massacre.